Greetings and welcome back. It's your host, Gabe Morales. Previously, we covered Chinese triads from their origins up until the point of World War II. Part two, we covered the growth of the triads outside of China after World War II and how they operated, including some of the main crimes they're involved in. Today, we're going to cover Chinese Tongs and Chinese American street gangs, which is a different thing, although they are influenced by the triads, as I will soon explain. The Chinese word Tongs in English means together. These were basically local Chinese benevolent associations. They held meetings in halls all across the United States where there was large Chinese populations. They were established during and after the mid-1800s railroad construction in the West, as well as in places like Chicago and New York's Chinatown. While the triads started in China, Tongs were Chinese-American organizations. As most of you know, I grew up in Seattle and frequently visited Chinatown, also referred to as the International District. When I was growing up in Seattle, I distinctly remember Chinese youth referring to two different factions. One was ABCs, or American-born Chinese, and FOBs, which were fresh off the boat, new immigrants from China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, etc. Chinese immigrants played a pivotal role in the development of the Washington Territory and that of Seattle. By 1880, more than 3,000 Chinese lived in the new U.S. territory, and they worked in various industries. Often there were riots between whites, who did not want them to be here, and Chinese who tried to defend themselves. In Seattle, there was a major riot in 1886, when violence erupted between Chinese and the Washington Knights of Labor, who wanted them out of town for taking American jobs. In nearby Tacoma, Washington, rioters burned the original Chinatown down to the ground. Down in Portland, Oregon, the racial situation was pretty much the same. But when there was violence there, it often was Chinese versus Chinese. On December 2nd, 1888, a deadly encounter occurred in front of Frank Woon's restaurant, located on 2nd Avenue and Alder Street, close to where the Morrison Bridge ramp now stands. Woon was the leader of the Hop Sing Tong in downtown Portland, and his group was engaged in takeover efforts to control gambling by the Bo Leong Society. A man named Ma Bin and other Bo Leong members were confronted. Both sides were carrying weapons. Eventually, approximately 50 shots were fired from a rifle and several people died on the Bo Leong side. Afterwards, Hop Sing announced its presence as the dominant Tong in the Rose City, and they remained a factor in Portland's Asian crime scene for over 100 years. There were also Tong Wars in San Francisco, but a San Francisco police inspector named Jack Mannion, leader of the Chinatown squad, forced six Tongs, the Hop Sings, the Sui Sings, the Sui Dongs, the Sen Sui Yings, the Jun Yings, and Bing Kong, or the six companies, to come together to form a peace committee in 1913, which lasted for many years. The Chi Kung Tong Society was a former Chinese society hall located in Wailuku, Maui, in the then Kingdom of Hawaii, and it was modeled on Freemason associations around the world. It was built to provide services to single immigrant Chinese males who mostly worked on sugarcane plantations in Hawaii, but it also provided a place for Buddhist religious worship and political help in addition to mutual aid that it provided. It suffered severe neglect until finally collapsing in 1996. As mentioned in the first video, when Dr. Sun Yat-sen's attempt to overthrow the Chinese emperor failed in 1895, he fled to America. Chi Kung Tong and Heaven and Earth Society provided Sun protection and helped raise money for him. Most historians agree that Dr. Sun joined the Chi Kung Tong in Honolulu in 1904. Sun and his supporters finally overthrew the Qing Dynasty emperor, and he was named the first president of a new Republic of China and is often referred to as being the father of the nation by both communist and nationalist Chinese. Dr. Sun Yat-sen served as the leader of the new Chinese government until his death in 1925 in Beijing. And as stated in previous videos, his main general, Chiang Kai-shek, then succeeded him as the nationalist leader, but lost to communist chairman Mao Zedong, and many Chinese fled to Hong Kong, Taiwan, or other parts of the world, including the United States. The 1890s saw the Chi Kung Tong at the peak of its power. The Bing Kong, or Kung Tong, was one of the most powerful organizations in San Francisco's Chinatown during the early 20th century. and the association became one of the largest in California after the Hop Sing and Sui Sing Tong were allied versus the Bing Tongs. This resulted in one of the most violent Tong wars to ever be documented in the United States until a truce was called. December 12, 1934, Wing Quang Lee, a member of the Hop Sing Tong headquartered in Seattle's Chinatown, was found dead lying in the streets. It was found that he had a severe head wound and had been bleeding profusely. A Seattle patrolman took him to Harborview Hospital, where he soon died from his injuries. March 20, 1935, Seattle police homicide detectives arrested a Hong Yik, who was a Sui Sing Tong hatchet man or assassin. This Tong was also headquartered in downtown Seattle's Chinatown, and Yik eventually confessed to the crime. After a short three-day trial in April 1935, he was convicted of first-degree murder and sentenced to death. With no real representation in court and no appeals filed on Yik's behalf, he was quickly hung on July 19, 1935, in Walla Walla at the Washington State Penitentiary. In 1948, a Seattle Chinese-American named Ruby Chow opened up a restaurant just a ways from Seattle's Chinatown, where one of her young staff was a future martial artist star named Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee actually studied Kung Fu in San Francisco as well as Seattle. And my father also studied the martial arts in the 1960s when Kung Fu was just becoming known to Americans. As stated before, the Tongs did a lot of good things for the community. In Seattle, the Changhua Benevolent Association started around 1915. This Tong was established to provide a unified voice for Chinese Americans in Washington State that were facing a lot of discrimination, as stated earlier. But there were some individuals that are also involved in negative things. And Ruby Chow took on Tong violence, especially after the 1983 Wami massacre, which I'll describe here shortly. If you saw my East Coast Gangs video, you know that I talked a lot about the Five Points and European American gangs, but there were also Chinese gangs in that area. The lower portion of Mott Street, just south of Canal Street, was considered to be part of the Five Points. In 1872, Wu Qi, a Chinese merchant, opened up a general store on Mott near Pell Street, and other Chinese businesses also started to flourish in the area. This area became known as New York's Chinatown. The An Leong Chinese Merchants Association also operated in Chicago's Chinatown. The An Leong Tong operated in the territory of Mott Street in New York's Chinatown. It was established in 1893 and was involved in a very violent war for control of Chinatown rackets with the Hop Sing Tong. The Hip Sing Association, also known as the Hip Sing Tong, was a Chinese-American organization that started in the U.S. around 1860 and is still active today in many areas. During the 1930s and 40s, the Hip Sings were involved in drug trafficking operations with the Kuomintang, or Chinese nationalists, according to many experts. Tsai Wing, a.k.a. Mok Duck, was a criminal leader of the Hip Sing Tong. Mok Duck arrived in the U.S. during the late 1890s and settled in Chinatown and quickly became involved in criminal activities. Within a few years, Mok Duck challenged a Tom Lee in the more established An Leong Tong for control of criminal activities in Chinatown. He bought off police and sought political protection of New York's famous Tammany Hall political machine. In 1900, Mok Duck demanded half of Lee's revenue from his illegal gambling operations. After Lee refused, Mok Duck declared war on him and his Tong. Hip Sing men soon set one of Lee's boarding houses on fire, which resulted in the deaths of two men. In another incident, an An Leong man was decapitated by two Hip Sing hatchet men as open warfare broke out in New York's Chinatown. Lee then put a bounty on Mok Duck's life, and he survived several assassination attempts. After several close calls, Mok Duck formed an alliance with the rival Four Brothers Tong and supplied information on Lee's An Leong Tong to the police, who raided many of Lee's criminal operations, including opium dens and gambling houses. Mok Duck finally defeated Lee in the Tong Wars of 1909 to 1910. In 1932, Mok Duck agreed to an arrangement by U.S. and Chinese governments to declare peace among the Tongs of Chinatown. He then retired to Brooklyn, where he lived until his death in 1941. As the Tongs became better known to police, the Ah Kung, or the elderly members of the Tongs, also called grandfathers, began to hire youth as lookouts. These were referred to as look-see boys, and the leaders of these groups were often referred to as being Dai Los, or the Big Brothers, and they were very eager to impress their elders as they engaged in criminal activities. As described earlier, Seattle's Chinatown had several Tongs, but many people were not aware of them until the Wami Massacre on February 18, 1983, when four business partners allegedly put up $15,000 each for high-stakes gambling. On this date, 14 people were shot and 13 of them died at the hands of Chinese gang members. I interviewed an individual who actually used to go to this club.
And you had a lot of offshoot Chinese gangs, and some of them went back to the old days of Chinatown.
You remember an incident called the Wami Massacre?
Yes, I do. I used to go gambling there.
Okay. You know an individual by the name of Willie Mack?
Not personally.
Okay. Do you remember the incident he was involved in there?
Yes, I do.
Can you tell us a little bit about that incident?
Well, it was an illegal gambling club, and to get in, you had to go in through one door, and there's a guy there, pat you down, make sure you're not carrying a gun, then you go through a second door where another guy was already holding the gun as you come in, and then you're checked again, then you go in and play, and there's a lot of money going through there, and those guys happen to stake it out. Which a lot of people did at the time. They always thought that'd be an easy place to take off. But being that it was in Chinatown and it was controlled by the Chinese people, Chinese gangs.
In Boston, near the end of Beach Street, is Ping An Alley, where Chinese workers first settled in the city in the 1870s. The Ping An Street Gang was allegedly started by Stephen Sky Dragon Say in the early 1980s. For much of the 1980s, Asian organized crime in Boston was controlled by Say and his henchmen. In his native Hong Kong, Say had been a member of the 14K Triad. What is unusual about this street gang is that Say became very attached to an individual named John Willis, also called the White Devil, who became very loyal to him in the Ping An gang. FBI agents who eventually caught the White Devil stated that they had never seen quite a criminal like Willis that held such high status within a Chinese street gang with close ties to the triads. The Huaqing street gang was started in 1964 in San Francisco. Huaqing literally means Chinese youth, and they were closely aligned with the 14K Triad. On September 4, 1977, the Huaqing had a violent confrontation with the Zhou Boys. The Zhou Boys were named after their leader, Zhou Fang, who was a former member of the Huaqing, but left them in 1971. These two groups were involved in the infamous Golden Dragon Massacre. My buddy Paul Losada speaks of that incident here.
Can you tell us, Paul, were there any heavy hitters, gang members that you dealt with, or incidents that still stand out in your mind today that you think, wow, that was a heavy situation? I wasn't sure if I was going to get through that one.
Well, you know, it kind of goes back like one stands out particularly when I was a kid growing up, the Golden Dragon Massacre, which I know you're familiar with that in the Asian gang, the Zhou Boys versus the Huaqings. So I was a kid coming up, and all the guys I trained with in the martial arts, some guys are Huaqings, some guys are Zhou Boys, man. So I knew them all. And it was like, wow, after that incident went down, I was like, to me, it's kind of like stuck in my head. It was like, wow, you know, I think the cops were undermanned during that time. Intelligence, nobody really was on the game. There's a few officers like Marshall Wong and a few of these guys who really had their finger on the pulse and, you know, they were able to put together that case, you know, which spanned, you know, a couple of states. The guy started fleeing and going everywhere else, you know. Yeah. So I thought that was really interesting, you know, of how that interplayed with my life during that time period. And it kind of helped motivate me to, you know, go into it. I knew about all the gangs.
After the Golden Dragon Massacre, the Zhou Boys faded away, but a new group took their place. These were the Jackson Street Boys, which, according to law enforcement, were very powerful in San Francisco's Chinatown during the 1980s and 90s. There were three brothers, Bobby, Johnny, and Tommy Sun, who were former Huaqing members who defected to the Wu Haptong and started the Jackson Street Boys, also known as the Black Dragons. And they forced most of the Huaqing into Southern California, where the Huaqing is very strong even today. An individual named Raymond Shrimpboy Chow, then 17 years old, was among the victims who survived. And as a Hop Sing Street Gang member, he swore revenge. Eventually, Shrimp Boy ended up hooking up with the Wap Toe Triad boss named Peter Chong. and the two plan to take over the Chinese street gangs in Chinatowns all across America under the leadership of the Wohawk Toll. In 2006, Shrimp Boy became leader of the Ji Kung Tong based in San Francisco. And in 2014, he and 20 other defendants, including former California Senator Leland Yee, were indicted for racketeering. What is unusual about this case is that Shrimp Boy had been posing as a reformed gang member and even giving gang intervention classes to youngsters.
I've been monitored by law enforcement 24/7, you know, and if I have anything, doing anything like this, definitely will be out there.
So Chow says City Hall has no reason to worry.
So you can look the mayor in the eye and say, look, Mayor Gavin Newsom, I'm a reformed man.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I can lower not just the mayor, anybody.
But it appears it was all cover for his future goals to become the king of Chinatown. The Ghost Shadows were a Chinese-American street gang that was prominent in New York City's Chinatown from the 1980s through the early 1990s. They were formed in 1971 by immigrants from Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Malaysia, and the gang was believed to be under the control of the An Leong Tong. Under Nicky Louie, the Ghost Shadows often engaged in bloody turf wars with other Chinatown gangs, like the Flying Dragons, Division Street Boys, and other gangs. It is also said that the Ghost Shadows had direct links to the Italian-American Mafia, and Little Italy was literally across the street, as the Italian bosses were busted under the RICO indictments and sent to federal prison. The Chinese organized crime groups grew stronger. But the gang suffered a heavy blow in 1995 when Louis was inducted on murder charges and racketeering and began cooperating with authorities. The Flying Dragons are another well-known Chinese-American street gang who were affiliated with the Hop Sing Tong. They were said to be very active in New York's Chinatown, but also had a presence in Chicago, Canada, Hong Kong, and even Australia. This gang moved heavily into heroin trafficking. The gang was sponsored by Uncle Benny Ong, considered by many to be the godfather of New York's Chinatown until his death. A Flying Dragon boss named Johnny Onionhead, a.k.a. Machine Gun Eng, was sentenced to 24 years imprisonment, 14 counts of heroin running, and conspiracy in 1993. I find it interesting that the rapper China Mac, who was born in Brooklyn and ran the streets of New York's Chinatown, became a member of the Ghost Shadows, even though his father was a leader in the Flying Dragons.
I grew up right here in Chinatown. And when I grew up, it was in the 80s. I was probably like 2-3 years old after I saw my first body out here, just laying on the street. Chinatown is right here, but Little Italy is right here, like right across the street. When the feds came and they took care of the mafia, Giuliani, he came, took down the whole mafia. Like the next year, he came right here to Chinatown and took out all the gangs in Chinatown. This is Canal Street, right? The gangs that was on Canal Street was the Vietnamese gang, BTK. This right here is the Fifth Precinct. This precinct used to be so busy back in the days. And I remember when I was a kid, I remember the gang that was right on this street right here, Born to Kill, right? They was mad because the police had locked one of them, the leader up, and they sent like three dudes over here and threw a grenade, threw two grenades in one of the cop cars, and a cop was in this shit.
There's also the Green Dragons, and even a movie made called Revenge of the Green Dragons, a 2014 crime film that lists Martin Scorsese as an executive producer, loosely based on exploits of the gang. But the Chinese were not alone. There was also Vietnamese and Southeast Asian gangs, as I covered in another video. A lot of the Vietnamese were actually Viet Chinh, or Vietnamese of Chinese extraction. And one gang that popped up in Chinatown, which became a major force against the other gangs, was the Born to Kill gang, which was composed of first-generation Vietnamese immigrants. In order to survive, the Born to Kill gang had to be even more violent than the Chinese gangs. And it is estimated they extorted approximately 70 shops located along Canal Street, which is the main street running through Chinatown. The BTK founder and leader was a David Tai, who was infamous for operating a multi-million dollar counterfeit watch business, many of which were sold along shops on Canal Street. Tai was also known for running a large brothel where he imported Southeast Asian women to serve as prostitutes. August 1991, Tai was arrested along with several other top-tier Born to Kill members on one of the gang's safe havens on Long Island. This arrest led to the conviction of seven members on federal racketeering charges in 1992, and Tai was sentenced to serve life, as were two other BTK members. And so, I know I went kind of quick, but I thought that gave you a glimpse of how the Tongs and Chinese street gangs operate. You can find a lot more information in my book, Asian and Pacific Islander Gangs, available on Amazon.com. I hope you enjoyed this three-part series and continue watching this channel as we cover other subjects in the gang world, criminal justice, and politics that affect you and all of us. For now, this is Gabe Morales signing off for Gangsters, Cops, and Politicians.